How you doing?
No vibes, no vibes. You ready?
Yeah, I'm ready. Let's go. Absolutely.
How's it going, everyone? David from DoD Media. Today we're going to be having a look at this lens. This is the Suhre 24mm f2.8 1.33x anamorphic lens. It's the third anamorphic lens produced by Suhre in this lineup of super affordable super 35mm anamorphic lenses. And that entire sequence you just watched was actually shot entirely using this lens and my Sony a7 III. Actually, not entirely. The very final shot where you saw the three lenses lined up was actually using a 24mm spherical lens in full frame mode to try and match that look. But other than that, everything was shot using this 24mm. Now, as usual with my gear reviews, I don't accept any payment to make the review, and the company making the product gets zero say in the actual content of the review of what I say. I do get to keep the lens once I've made the review, but since I don't see the point in making reviews for gear that I wouldn't recommend, the fact that you're watching this now means that I was impressed by this lens. So you may or may not have seen the previous reviews that I made for the previous two anamorphic lenses, the 50mm f1.8 and the 35mm f1.8, both 1.33x aspect ratio. But those are both pretty fantastic lenses considering what they do versus how much they cost and the niche that Suhre still holds on this market of cheap, anamorphic, affordable lenses. So I was really excited when Suhre got in touch to ask if I'd like to test out the third edition to that affordable lineup of anamorphics, which is this, the 24mm f2.8. The lens follows the same design as the previous two, though it's the longest one by a little fraction over the 35mm, and it doesn't have the same fast aperture, the 1.8 aperture, it's down to 2.8. But to be honest, I don't feel like that's such a bad thing considering how wide it is. When I'm shooting this wide, I don't particularly need a shallow, hair-thin depth of field. I quite like seeing my whole scene. The filter thread is 72mm, which is fine if you're using a matte box or you already own filters of that size. But since a lot of my lenses are 67mm, like the Sigma that you're filming on now, or these two in fact are both 67 as well, I invested in 67mm filters, which work great on the 50mm and 35, but can't use them on this, even with a step-up ring, because you would just see that vignetting, that edge of that filter. So it's a little bit of a shame that they didn't stick with 67 on this. I don't know if it was a limitation of size or what. And that's really a subjective issue I have with it because it only affects me. I'm sure other people have bigger filters and they thought ahead and bought bigger filters with step down rings. Or is it step up rings? I'm never sure which one it is. But either way, you got rings and you got the bigger filters. I'll just have to invest in bigger filters or a matte box. Now the flaring on this lens is really nice. It's not completely over the top, but you will definitely get that typical anamorphic streak flare across the screen whenever there's a light source that is pointing in or from the side of the lens. And there's a nice amount of light washing if you have a bright light source pointing into the lens or from the side as well, like a sun. Like in that shot where the boot opens, you can see where it really kind of, it saps the contrast of the image, but not too much, just a little bit to make it really aesthetically pleasing. Of course, you can get rid of that by using a matte box with the barn doors adjusted to block out that extra light if you want to. Now with the 35mm, I received a Micro Four Thirds mount and then this E-mount adapter that I had to screw onto it, which was handy in the sense of being, you know, modular, but actually it means that there is a certain risk of user error when putting that mount on there, especially with E-mount where the flange of the lens is so close to the sensor that even the tiniest fraction of a misalignment will misalign your lens and potentially give you a softer image or just not as good of an image. So luckily the 24mm, because it comes in a wider variety of mounts, it comes directly with the mount that you have ordered. So make sure you order the right mount. But anyway, that means that because it comes natively mounted, it's done in a factory, it's done properly, there is no risk of user error, and this lens, as a result of that, is sharper than a Japanese kitchen knife, even wide open. One thing I did miss in the box was these fitted focus gears that came with the 35mm. That was such a nice touch, and I was a bit disappointed to see that they didn't come with the 24mm. I wouldn't need the aperture one necessarily, but having that focus gear on there, instead of having to have these ones with the kind of, you know, the wraparound knuckle job, they're just not as good. It's much nicer to have something that is fitted to it, so it's a shame that that wasn't on there. But then again, I'm pretty sure this is a pre-production model, so it may well be that it actually comes with the final model. I don't know that. Okay, so let's have a look at some more footage examples. Now, if you look at a conventional 24mm spherical lens on a full-frame sensor, and compare that to the anamorphic 24mm on the same camera, in the same place, but put into super 35mm crop mode, and then de-squeeze the anamorphic image in post, you can see that we're almost achieving the same horizontal width on a crop sensor as we are on a full frame sensor. The reason being that despite the Super 35 sensor being a 1.5 times APS-C crop sensor, the lens has an aspect ratio of 1.33 times, which means that it's squeezing 33% more horizontal info into the image. So really, you're only losing about 17% of your frame width with the anamorphic lens, as opposed to the 50% that would be lost to a standard spherical lens in Super 35 mode. Now, just for experiment's sake, here's what the 24mm projects onto a full frame. Now, if I don't go into crop mode on the camera, this is what you get, this heavy vignetting. Since it's a super 35mm lens, it just doesn't project beyond the APS-C range. There's no data there. However, it does open up an interesting option. If you're willing to compromise on image quality a tiny bit, what we can do in our editing software is de-squeeze the image, as we would normally do with anamorphic footage, and we scale it up until those harsh vignettes are cropped out of frame. And this achieves two things. It allows you to get an ever so slightly wider field of view than you get by shooting in Super 35 mode, in crop mode, but it also allows you to get a 16:9 image back instead of being stuck with the 240:1 CinemaScope crop. I think ultimately, if your plan is to shoot in 4K and deliver in 1080, this is a workable solution to get a 16:9 anamorphic image without losing too much on quality, since you'll still be downscaling to 1080p. But I probably wouldn't recommend it if your plan is to shoot and deliver in 4K. In that case, I would just consider this a fun experiment and continue using Super 35 crop mode. So I mentioned the previous two lenses in the anamorphic series, the 50mm and the 35mm, and it wouldn't make sense for me to mention them and not show you how they compare. So here's the 24mm from a different angle this time, with an LED pointing straight down the lens so you see how it handles flaring. Keeping the camera at the same distance and the focus on the same subject, here's the 35 and the 50. I think it's important to show these three together because it shows how well they perform as a set, and I have no doubt that once the 24mm is released that Suray will begin selling these as a kit. Three anamorphic primes for under $3,000. I kind of want to do like the mind blown emoji. I think it's truly incredible what Suray have embarked on as a challenge to bring anamorphic cinema lenses to an affordable professional market. There will be a link in the description once the lens has launched. First it'll be to the Kickstarter campaign and then it will be to the actual product itself once it has launched. Honestly, I can't wait to see what Suray come up with next. It's really amazing. I don't use the word inspiring often, but it's pretty inspiring. All right, that's it from me. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this review, give it a thumbs up, hit that subscribe button, ring that bell, and I'll see you next time. Cheers.